It's pretty wonderful that we're in the midst of the Olympics to have this reading from the Epistle and St. Paul reminding us that he himself was quite an athlete. He enjoyed competition, and he was known for really, you know, working out at the Roman gym, as it were, and being a part of that part of the culture, the physique. And he liked marathons. He loved races and stuff like that. So when he used that metaphor, we are really about persevering in the long race. He is speaking from that kind of experience. He knows what it is, physically, mentally, emotionally, to persevere in those kinds of competitions. Now, the one thing that I really noticed and lift up before we get to talking about Luke a little bit is that for St. Paul, success wasn't necessarily in victory. It wasn't equated with the win, you know, the goal. I mean, that's all admirable, and those goals are awesome. But for St. Paul, his sense of victory did not come from what we might consider earthly successes. His sense of victory, as he sat there in prison, or later as he sat there being condemned to death, and in fact, as he was dying, his sense of success and victory were very much not bound to earthly things. He had got to that place that Jesus, through the Gospels, has been telling us for the last several weeks, the ability to really recognize value in his faith and his relationship with God, and what that witness, how that impacted the lives of those around him. The ability to say, you know, those successes that we might have and strive for in life are so fleeting. And they're not the thing that we should get most bound up about. That we can pursue those things. We have no shame in that. But it's not the ultimate, most important thing. But those opportunities to share in human relationships, in the precious gift of life that we have right now, to make differences right now in the quality of other people's lives, to be present to other people's lives, especially our children, or our aging parents, as we have them and as we can. That is the way that we build up currency in the kingdom of heaven. That stays with us at the end of our lives, whatever that moment may be. And we don't know, right? You're the bridegroom. We don't know. You know, when are you going to get surprised with the Savior or God saying, time's up, right? And so we want to be ready somehow. To be ready that we have truly lived so fully. Now, I use that as a prelude as we get to Luke and the reading that we've heard today. Reminding ourselves that the Gospel of Luke wasn't written down until right around the year 80 to 100. So things have already happened. There's already been a couple generations of Christians and history under the belts of the Christian community in which this is being written. And furthermore, Luke continued to be edited on way into the second century. The version that we have had a lot of commentary added into it and understanding added into it by the first couple centuries of Christian community. And that collective wisdom is very important for us to understand. The history that informs Luke writing about fire, for example, and the potential destruction, and how, you know, don't get too attached to your stuff or the place where you are. Because he really lifts up, even as Paul lifts up, that we are people of journey. And journey people we're nomadic, we're semi-nomadic. We might put up our tents a little bit in one place, so we gotta be ready to strike those tents and move on. Wherever God is asking us to be in the world, we are people on a journey. And the goal of our life is not the just destination at all. It is not the momentary, fragile human successes at all, as good feeling as those might be for us. Our deeper identity is not in those successes, not in those medals, as it were, but rather our profound and ongoing identity is in the journey we have with God, which is ultimately our journey in humanity, in creation, with one another. That doesn't stop until that last bit of the Holy Spirit that's been ebbing and flowing through us is given back to God. And gosh, we are to ride that wave all the way through and say, yee-haw, as much as we can. That would gain space from Luke. And the reason is, in the time in which he's really trying to lift up and protect and nurture his community, just a few years, about 10 years before this starts getting written down, some very genuine catastrophe happened to the Jewish and Christian community in Jerusalem. Namely, from about the year 63 until 76, the Jews were embroiled in a rebellion with the Roman Empire. This is interesting to note that the further context of this rebellion from 63 to 76 is the fact that the Roman Empire has just said about itself some years earlier that it is enjoying the Pax Romana, the peace of Rome, which they then claim goes on to about 125. And they say even maybe it started earlier, into the early 200s BC, because of the way the Roman Empire basically enforced peace wherever it conquered peoples. Now, in the case of Judea, Israel, Jerusalem, these places have been occupied by the Roman Empire, and the peace of Rome looks like subjugation, it looks like economic exploitation, it looks like horrible corruption and neglect of the needs of the people, into poverty extremists in certain cases, and the alienation of people. So all of that is the kind of peace when Jesus is saying through Luke, I do not come to bring you peace. I think it's that Pax Romana, peace in quotes. I'm not coming to bring you an experience where I would subject you into submission and terrify you if you go against me. Remember, this is being written down in the midst of rebellious period, or informed by it, certainly. So I'm not asking you to be submissive. I am, says Jesus, asking you to understand where you can put your energy, and rather into sort of rebellion, to put energy into creating the kingdom of God. Not a negative energy of force. If you live by the sword, you die by the sword. But an energy of creativity. An energy that, even in the midst of the darkest challenges, refuses to be submitted to those challenges. But is always dedicated to the creative forces of love and justice. That brings about true peace and true change in Christ. Now, what happens in the year 70, just 10 years or so before Luke starts being written down, the rebellion reaches a critical height, and it happens in Jerusalem. Jerusalem is the symbolic capital of the Hebrew world, and still at that point, the capital known world of the Christian fledgling community, the place that is still very much informed by. Now, in the year 70, during the time of the Passover feast, many people, as during the time of Christ, 70 years earlier, as they come into Jerusalem, the town is now swelling with people. It's basically more than quadrupled in size and population. Whenever Passover happens, you remember that the Roman Empire would get very nervous because they only have, a legion or so of soldiers dealing with all these people who come into Jerusalem. And the various rebellious factions that have been operating on the countryside are very much present in Jerusalem in the year 70. And they're arguing among themselves. And when Luke is talking about your houses will be divided, and he gives Jesus these words warning about how I'm not here to bring you to peace. In fact, you're all going to kind of hate each other's guts. Because you're all going to have different worldly ideas about what should be done about the Roman Empire. And many of you are going to want to put your energies into fighting, rather than into creative transformation of that. So you have the choice, free will, and you can put your energies into the rebellion. And they certainly did, Christians and Jews alike. Now the Christians were more sympathetic toward the idea of nonviolence. And so they weren't very appreciated by various factions of Hebrews who were saying, you need to fight with us against the Roman Empire. After the year 70, just a footnote for you, Christians were no longer permitted to enter synagogues. for that reason. They were pacifists in it. And then when the factions of Hebrews continued to fight, that contributed basically to their downfall. Because what happened was the Roman Empire, Emperor Titus, brings in his forces to Jerusalem. Jerusalem is surrounded by three barriers and walls, and the Romans are able to get through the first two pretty readily within the first couple of weeks of taking it on. But that third wall, that third barrier, was the biggest, the thickest, and hardest to get through. And so they laid siege to Jerusalem and the temple, which was behind the wall, for 7 months. So you can understand, they set fire to the food stores, so that's not many people. And for 7 months, they basically hold up under siege, very little food, very little supplies, and life is looking awful in there. And the factions are still fighting each other about what to do. And then finally, late in September of 70, they breach that third wall. And the way that they are successful is they essentially light fire to it. Limestone is one of the few stones that can burn. And they are able to get a hot enough fire through that thick wall and light the fortress that they are able to eventually burn the whole of Jerusalem. Now, we have historians of the time telling us that over a million people died, but the problem with that figure is there were only about a million people in all of Palestine at that time. So we know that he's basically trying to tell us that several thousand people died, and we think at least 6,000 in that time of taking over Jerusalem. And more than that, probably triple that amount, were then enslaved after the siege, Jews and Christians, enslaved and sent on a diaspora to various other parts of the Roman Empire so that they couldn't cause too much trouble there. Some were able to remain though, some Christians, some Jews, but most of them went on another diaspora, including the Christian community, who now is no longer welcomed in Jerusalem and no longer welcomed in the synagogues in the Alpine countryside. And so they are really under challenge about what is their identity now. And now that they don't have Jerusalem, now that they don't have sort of a center to go to, how do they possibly get steam under them? And this is really one of the most crucial reasons why the gospel even gets out into the four quarters of the world, is because their religious center was burnt to the ground. But out of that destruction and death and horror comes another opportunity. And the gospel and the early Christian community, because they're sent out on diaspora, they basically end up going and sharing the message of the good news all over the known world at the time. What that reminds me of is studies I once did in biology around the impact of fire on certain kinds of environments, natural environments, like the chaparrales in South America or prairies. There are certain kinds of biomes that need fire in order for other plant species to continue to procreate or germinate. Certain seeds lie dormant until fire takes out the territory they were in, heats the seeds up enough so that they're kind of spurned into their generation. And also taking out any competitive kind of plants that would block out the sun. Because of fire, the soil changes and makes it the right pH for those new seeds to take root and make a new green. And that to me is part of what is creative and destructive but ultimately restorative about this symbol of fire. It's because we experience, whether it's in our personal lives, experiences of profound devastation, whether it's emotional or real. Right now we've seen thousands of families losing their houses to floods, for example, in the South right now. When we lose all that, when we have really horrible diagnoses given to us or those we love, we can, as a part of our genuine faith journey, ask the question, God, why are you doing this? And we put the agency of why it's happening out onto God. Because certainly God's supposed to be all-powerful, omnipotent, yada, yada, yada. And so it's tempting to say the problem is God's, God did it. God's awful because this awful thing happened. The thing with that is it completely takes away our collaborative, co-creational role and responsibility in the world to basically put all of it off onto God. God who blessed us with free will about what we eat and what we do to our environment, what we do in our international relationships, and what we do when we put our money in disease research, how we address issues of hunger and war. Those aren't us, people. Those aren't us. And yes, accidents and horrific things in nature happen, and that doesn't mean that God is bad. As we've been hearing from Ecclesiastes and Luke throughout the last several weeks, it's a part of what it means to be mortal. Bad stuff happens in part because it's the nature of our lives. It's not because some divine creator said we're horrible or we deserve it or just because. It's a part of what it is to be in this world, that we are subject to the things that happen in it, that we are so not in control of. And that's the real rub. And so the lessons we've been hearing, even as we're hearing it from Luke again, repeatedly, don't get too attached to your stuff. Don't even get too attached to the place where you are. Don't get too attached to your family that you're not ready to go where God is calling you to go and to be what God is asking you to be. And so we have finally in this example that God is offering us not a Pax Romana, a false peace, in which we are subject to an angry God who will blight us if we do not obey. Rather, we are offered something far more challenging. The opportunity to work with God, beside God, in creating the kingdom of heaven that through us the Holy Spirit would bring into being in this here and this now, on this earth, in times of great challenge and stress, globally, economically, or personally, that is when we are most especially asked to take the long view that something beyond our vision and this now and this place is what God is cultivating. The fire prepares something new.